Hi everyone, Jolyn Hall here with Schmidt Realty Group Incorporated, and today I'm presenting selling your last home for the first time, because many of the home sellers I work with have lived in their home 20, 30, 40, or even more years. And so this process of downsizing from your family home or the main home that you've lived in most of your life can be really overwhelming. And so today I just want to give you a quick overview of what you need to know about the market and what you need to understand so that you can be fully prepared for selling your home. So I'm going to just start sharing my screen. So give me a moment because I'm just going to switch into my slides here. So give me 2 seconds. There we go. So now you should be able to see my screen as we go through these details. So as I mentioned, planning to sell your last home for the first time. So my name, as I mentioned, is Jolyn Hall, and I'm with Schmidt Realty Group, and I'm a seniors real estate specialist there. My background is quite diverse in that I started my career as a registered nurse and case manager with home care, and then I've moved into seniors housing. So over the last 25 years, I've been assisting older adults and their families navigate housing transitions. And when it was time for a transition for myself, real estate seemed to be the way to be, to do things a little bit differently for my clients, because I understand their health needs, I understand their aging challenges, and I just look at the market a little bit more differently. And so as we get into what we're doing here, you'll be able to see a little bit more of my background and what makes me a little bit different in real estate. So let's carry on. So today we're going to talk about understanding the market. We're going to talk about understanding the process, deciding when to sell, and preparing to sell. So it's going to be a very quick, basic conversation today, and I'll leave opportunities for you to ask questions until the end. So understanding the market. We often hear terms such as buyer's market, seller's market, and right now we're in a buyer's market in that there is more inventory than buyers, so there's lots of choices for them. We talk about stabilization because the market goes up and down every day. And so we look for stabilization when we're getting close to buyer's market and seller's market equalizing. They're not up, they're not down. And so before all of this that has happened in the world, we were very close to stabilization. And it's going to be interesting to see what comes in the next coming months. I want to preface that condo sales and home sales are very different. There's a lot of different aspects in terms of marketing and managing each of those pieces. So just know in general, I'm talking about home sales. Some of this will apply to condo sales, and I'll kind of try to separate out and point out some of those details as we go along, but they are very different. And at the end of the day, the market is very neighborhood specific. I kind of hate the realtor board stats that talk about, you know, Edmonton market. Edmonton is full of many micro niche markets. And so there's a lot of really small markets that are doing spectacular, and there's other markets in Edmonton that are doing less. And so we kind of can't speak about Edmonton in general. We need to speak about neighborhoods specifically when we're looking at marketing. And the market always changes. It changes day by day, month by month, and we never know what to expect. So it's important to be aware that the market is always flowing like a river. It changes moment by moment. So one of the first things you need to understand as a home seller is understanding your home value. And there's a number of ways to come to that: a comparative market analysis or an appraisal. So an appraisal is a service provider you pay. They'll come to your home, look inside and out, and come up with a price for that day, because they use a lot of different data And their appraisals, when used by banks and services of that nature, are very time-limited services. Comparative market analysis is usually done by a real estate agent, so you can generally contact any agent you're comfortable with or know, and invite them out to your home. They're going to look at your home value from what the condition is, the neighborhood statistics, what's sold, what's active, where your home compares in there, and come up with a market value, which really isn't a determination of your house value. It's what would buyers perceive as the appropriate value for your home. So when we talk about the sales process, as you're preparing to sell your home, really your steps are quite simple. It's choosing your representation, if any, preparing for the sale, maximize your showings, negotiate your sale price, and prepare for possession day. So I'm going to sort of break this down for you, and we're going to go piece by piece into all of that right now. So choosing your representation. In Alberta, you have a lot of choices. You can choose a real estate agent, a discount brokerage. You can do a private sale. And so it's really what meets your needs best. When you're choosing to work with a real estate agent, we have a legal fiduciary duty and loyalty to your best interests. So it's not about what I want. It's not about what you may want. It's really what works in your best interest is how we're going to advise you. We have a lot of neighborhood knowledge. And as we talked about the different markets, neighborhoods are really important in understanding how to not only sell your home, but market your home, the type of buyers to attract to your home, and things of that nature. And so a real estate agent is going to have that neighborhood knowledge. Recently, when I did a second opinion for a client and was looking at relisting their townhouse, we noticed that in the comments, there was no schools listed. I know that client's townhouse was less than a block away from a very specialized school in Edmonton that a lot of families plan their accommodation based on what's close and accessible to that school. And so by just knowing the neighborhood, knowing that school, knowing what we need to do, we could actually market that home very differently. And that leads into my next piece on marketing knowledge. It is not about putting up a for sale sign that sells your home. It's a lot of marketing knowledge in terms of trends and what's going on and what buyers respond to that helps a home get sold. So a real estate agent is going to be able to help you with that, as well as strategy and negotiation, especially as you receive offers, especially as you figure out any pricing adjustments, things of that nature. There's a lot of strategy behind everything we do. But the most important piece is you get guidance every step of the way. You are not alone. And so you have somebody to lean on through the good times, the bad times, to suggest ideas to talk through what's going on and truly understand what's happening with the sale of your property. Now, all agents are not created equal, and that's shocking for some people. We all do marketing in very different ways, and that's why it's important to meet with real estate agents to kind of interview, at least chat with them by phone or video call to get a sense of how they work. Do they just get your property listed on MLS and wait for the buyers to come? Do they list it on MLS, do some basic marketing, and wait for the buyers to come? Or do they engage a lot of modern marketing, have brochures available for showings, do social media marketing, and actively search for the buyers to bring to you? So it's important to understand which one your agent fits into. I'm stage three. I do a lot for my clients. And I'll show you a little bit later what that looks like. You can sell with a discount brokerage. So these are generally ones that advertise lower commissions or flat rate commissions. So you have to realize that for everything an agent does, there is usually a service behind that fee to substantiate that. there is no set commissions in Edmonton. So as a seller, you always want to ask what that looks like, but no, there is no set commission. It's generally set by the brokerage or individual agents, depending who you're working with. So always ask that question. But oftentimes, if they have lower fees, then generally there's some lower services. So you always want to ask what exactly those fees include. What is their marketing plan? What are all of the fees in case there's things you'll be paying for that you didn't know about? And what are their hours and accessibility? You can also do a private sale. This is where you assume the full responsibility for the legalities of this sale. So basically, you've found a buyer, you've negotiated and come to a deal, and basically you're going to have a lawyer draw up all the paperwork. They're just going to follow your lawful instructions. So they're not going to put in terms or conditions necessarily to protect you because this isn't their specialty. So it's just understanding and working with a lawyer that's familiar with real estate and protecting yourself as much as possible, because you will be responsible for the negotiation and strategy on your own. So again, you can use a real estate agent, you can use a discount brokerage, and you can do a private sale for selling your home. So as you get ready to sell your home, there's a couple terms that you need to know or at least hear about as you prepare. One is the real property report. If you are in a bare lands condo or in a single family home dwelling on property, you need to have a survey done of your property and a real property report created and sent to the city for a compliance stamp. If you've purchased your home probably in the last 20 years, you might have a real property report already. And if no structures in your backyard have changed at all, that's still valid. So that's something an agent's going to go through with you as to, do you have a valid real property report or do you need to make amendments and get an updated one? Building permits. This is always such a tough conversation, especially if you've lived in your home for many decades. Chances are when you developed your basement or built your covered deck, you might not have needed permits. And so an important conversation we're going to have is what permits are worth getting, what permits are not, and what implications that's going to mean for buyers and the saleability of your home. And the last thing that's important to hear about is title insurance. And title insurance is something that is purchased by your lawyer on your behalf for the buyer, usually. And it can protect you in cases where you don't have the ability to get a real property report, or you suspect there might be some issues with encumbrances or issues with neighboring properties to you. There's a number of instances where we'll use title insurance in a sale, but it's important to understand that it can protect buyers from things they don't know about. And that also protects you in your liability, because you do have liability in the sale if things aren't disclosed. So title insurance can give you a little bit of protection in that deal. So as we prepare to sell, we need to understand what the cost of selling is for us. So your service fees are your commission that you might pay to a realtor or discount brokerage. And so those vary agent by agent, and so important to ask those questions and what those service fees include and if there's any additional fees in their contract. Legal costs, you do need a lawyer to close and complete your transaction. So quite often on an average home in Edmonton, I see legal costs usually in the $1,500 to $2,500 range. It really just depends on the complexity of your particular deal. If you have a lot of holdbacks or terms to be upheld possibly after a deal is done, then there might be higher legal costs associated for you. Your real property report for most properties in Edmonton will cost you around $700 to $800 to get that done. But if you do have a non-compliant stamp and need to do some upgrades to make that compliant, there may be some additional costs. One way to manage some concerns that we might have about the property would be purchasing title insurance, and that's often for around $250 to $300. If you live in a condo, whether you're Barelands or conventional condo, you will be required to provide condo documents to your buyers when they make an offer. And so there's been new legislation this year, which has greatly helped condo owners in terms of reducing your costs. But do expect sort of between $350 to $700. It really depends how your condo corporation or board manages those documents and costs. And then financing costs. This may be if you're terminating a mortgage early, or if you've taken out a second mortgage on your home, or had a reverse mortgage or an equity line of credit. There may be some banking pieces you need to close off as part of your housing deal. And so there might be some penalties or other fees associated with that. So even though you're selling, it's important to understand and look into those before you start the sale process. So now we're getting ready to sell, we're prepared. You need to start deciding on price. And it is not picking the price you want and listing it at that. You can do that, but I can't promise you will have success or that that will be a defendable price for you. So when I work with clients, when we're deciding their price, we work on what is a defendable price that I can justify to a buyer, because we know they're going to create an offer lower than our price. Seldom do we get an offer of exactly what we're asking for. And so we need to make sure we create a defendable price. And we do that through a thorough market and neighborhood review. We're looking at what's going on in the greater market. We're looking at what's going on in the local market, in the neighborhood. But we're also looking at the actives that are currently listed. We're looking at the past sales in the last 6 months, 12 months, 24 months, and seeing what's going on with them. We're looking at things like, is there a big tower about to be built on your street? We're looking at, is road construction going on? We're looking at, is it going to be hard for somebody to park here to view this? We're looking at your neighbors, you know, are they noisy and disruptive? Do they have an uninhibited property that's not well taken care of? What does that look like? And together we're going to develop a pricing strategy. And then the other conversation that I often have with people is, do they need to do a pre-inspection? And especially on an older home, this gives us, it's a full building inspection, just like a buyer would do, but it's going to give us a heads up to what's going on. So is there a problem with the electrical? Is there any problem with plumbing issues? Is something getting old or near the end of its life that's going to get alerted to a buyer in their building inspection? Do we want to get ahead of it? And sometimes that helps us price the home, because we can price for the current condition and state going, we know about the electrical issue, we know the roof needs to be done. We've priced this accordingly because we know you have these upcoming repairs. So on older homes, we'll often have this discussion about, do you need a pre-inspection? So let's talk about the sales process. This is often a piece I go through with my buyers, but this can often be helpful for a seller to understand what the process looks like and what timelines can look like. So you make your listing of your home active, you have showings, you're going to receive a purchase contract, hopefully at some point, and that's also known as your offer. You're then going to negotiate price, conditions, terms. You're going to hopefully come to an agreement on all of that, and that makes you pending. And then as those conditions like building inspection, condo fee, review, financing condition all get removed, that's when you are officially sold. And then there's a gap to possession day, often 30 to 60 days, depending on the conditions of your sale and how you set that up. So when you're deciding your timeline, we're looking at when you need to sell. So where are you moving to? Have you already vacated the property? Have you already looked and figured out where you're moving? Possibly bought and or rented something? Are you looking for a move in a specific time of year? And are you moving before or after your sale? Because a lot of how we're going to list your property depends on what your plans are for moving. Time of year, my sellers always ask this question, when the best time to sell is. And there is no particular season. I sell year round. I have buyers and sellers that I'm working with in every season. But every season is a different experience. And so when my sellers decide to list, I'm coaching you through what to expect in that season for your listing. The best way to know the best time to sell for you is sell as soon as you are ready. Because the sooner you are on the market, the better your chances of that one buyer possibly looking and seeing your listing. If you wait too long and they've come and gone from the market, you may have missed them and might be sitting longer. You never know. And we use that same sales timeline that I just showed you to work backwards. So if you know that you have to move into a place by September, we're going to work through that timeline to go, when should you be listed, to give you the time. So I've got a sample timeline here. So if you're going to move by September, you need your conditions removed about 60 days in advance. So that would be in July. You need to have accepted an offer by mid-June. You need to have received an offer in early June. And if the average days on market is 70 days, then you need to be listed by mid-March. So that just gives you a rough idea of how I work with timelines for my clients. As you're preparing for the sale, some of this you're going to do before you list. Sometimes we're doing this while we're listed, but decluttering and cleaning, it's really important. If there's excess items you can get rid of or box up or put away, it's great if you can do that. And I coach all my clients through what that looks like. And these days in a buyer's market, the cleaning is really important. I have had buyers walk into beautiful homes, but the light switches were dirty or the baseboards were dirty, and they make an assumption that the home is not well taken care of and they decide to walk away. So the cleaning is almost more important than the decluttering, but we work on that. Maintenance and repairs. If it's little things, if you've got especially a door lock that's sticky, if you have light bulbs that are out, if you have a piece of flooring that's loose or needs to be replaced, if your deck rails are a little loose, do those quick and easy maintenance and repairs on all of it. Because buyers are picky and so are building inspectors, and we don't want to give them any little thing. We want them to know that the home is well maintained and well taken care of. The other frequent question I get is, should I renovate or not? Oh, my kitchen's really dated. I should maybe redo that before I list. I actually have a very different stance on renovate versus not. It's really about what your goals are. So my answer isn't the same for everyone. If your goal is to get top dollar out of your home, renovating some elements might help you get there. But if your goal is to get out of your house as quick as possible, then maybe we're best to leave it as is, price it for the condition it's in, and let somebody else renovate it. The tough thing about renovations is usually you only get back 20 to 60% of the value you put into it. So those renovations can be very expensive. You don't get your full money back out of it. And the next buyer might not like your taste or your choices and still rip it all out even though it's new. So I go through a process with my clients to determine whether renovating or not works best for you in your circumstances. And most importantly, get help where you need it. A lot of my clients are 55 plus. Packing, decluttering, doing maintenance can all be quite hard and strenuous, especially if you have other stresses going on in your life. So I work with great professionals, whether it is repair and maintenance you need, whether you need a professional organizer to help you declutter and downsize some of your space, whether you need packers and movers to come pack up some things or elements of your home, whatever that will look like. I have referrals to great service providers that provide quality services at great rates. And so pull upon others, including your own family, for some help rather than do it all on your own. So we're listed, yay, you're on the market, but now we need to maximize your showing. These days, the online showing is your first showing. photos matter immensely. It's why for all of my listings, I hire a professional photographer. There is no cost to my clients. They do not pay for it, but I want their images looking realistic and appropriate. I don't want it distorted. I don't want a room looking bigger than it is. I want it looking as real and as close to possible as real life there is. So a lot of agents are happy to take photos on their phone, or owners that are listing themselves take photos on their own with their phone, but you don't always get the best lighting. You don't always get the best view of the space. And so having good photos matters, because most buyers come looking on realtor.ca. And if your photos don't stand out on there, they're just gonna bypass you. Even if you've got an amazing home, if your photos don't show it, they're just gonna keep going. You need to always be show ready. I can't tell you how many times I have buyers contact me on 1, 2, or 3 hours notice wanting to see a home. So we never know when that's gonna happen. So once you're listed, it is keeping your property in a show ready state. Or like I provide to my clients, oftentimes a quick checklist of things to do to get out of the house and ready for your showings. And try to accommodate all showings. I know there's times you're tired or your favorite show is on or something else is going on in your life, but every showing you refuse or turn down might be the buyer that was gonna buy your home. So I do work with clients with very complex needs. I work with clients that have somebody with dementia in the home. That makes it difficult for showings. I deal with those that have very low mobility and can't necessarily leave the home for all showings. So there's a variety of ways I work around all of that. So if showings and getting out or preparing for them is a concern, always bring that up with your agent to discuss what the strategies are so that you don't miss out on any showings. Finally, when you do get an offer, negotiations are an extremely emotional process, and I always tease that this is where my service fees really help you out. Because this is not easy. Somebody has made possibly a lowball offer on your home that you've loved and cherished and taken care of for a long time. So when it comes to negotiations, you need to try to be objective. Somebody is buying four walls and a roof. To them, there isn't the memories, there isn't the emotional attachment. They're just buying a building, and that's how they're treating the negotiations. They're not attacking you. They're not attacking how you've cared for the home, but I get it can feel that way at times. So try to see it from the buyer's perspective. Try to see what they're looking at and how they're thinking. Know your bottom line before negotiations start. If you have your home listed, but you know that you're comfortable to go about $25,000 less than that, or you've got enough wiggle room to go about $50,000 less, those are conversations we're going to have early on, because it might just come down to that, especially in a buyer's market, especially where buyer's confidence is shifted or shaken at all. Having that conversation in advance, knowing what your bottom line is, means that we might just be able to get your home sold with a bit of work. But it helps me as an agent to understand what that bottom line looks like. I'm still going to fight and negotiate for you to get the highest price possible. But sometimes we just have to notice when we have a buyer that we need to take advantage of their offer. And that's especially if we've had a stale listing that hasn't had many showings, hasn't had many offers. Sometimes we need to reevaluate our pricing. And your first offer is usually the best offer you will get. I know that's not something sellers like to hear. It is statistically the case. And so you have to be careful turning down first offers, thinking, oh, there'll be many more. There might be more, there might not, but they might also not be as high. In the early days, people don't want to risk going into multiples. And so they'll generally give you a fairly decent offer right off the bat to avoid multiples, but you just never know. So I'd always coach you through all of that. When your home isn't selling, there's three elements you are in control of. You're in control of the price, you're in control of the marketing, and you're in control of your readiness to negotiate. If a house is not selling, we look at a process of, have you had showings? Have you had offers? And what is stopping showings and or offers? And so usually we're looking at changing one of these three. Because if you've had offers and you haven't been able to come to a deal, whose side was affecting the willingness to negotiate? If it's been a pricing issue, maybe it's too high for the neighborhood or buyer confidence has shifted. So if your home isn't selling, we need to look at these three and figure out where the shift needs to happen to get it sold. At the end of the day, I need you to know that real estate is really about matchmaking. We're just trying to find one right buyer. We're not looking for mass people. We're not looking for tons of showings. At the end of the day, we're looking for one just right buyer. So don't get discouraged. It's really easy to get started with me. Generally, we start with a complimentary comparative marketing analysis to see what your home would sell or list at in today's current market. So I can definitely help you with homes, condos, acreages. We'll work to figure out what your timeline looks like, whether you're moving before or after you move. Together, we'll develop your best marketing plan, and we'll get you on the market with confidence that you know everything that's about to happen in the process and know that you've got someone on your side to help you with it all. I know this is a lot of information. This is just some of the benefits of working with me. So a couple of key things. I provide professional photos of your property. I have an interior designer that'll do a consultation on staging your home with what you have. I create a website with your home address so that anybody searching it up is going to find that website first. We have a very comprehensive and modern marketing package. Full color brochures, our signage even includes your custom website, a weekly stat review, an easy exit agreement, referrals to any services you need, and you're part of our VIP coverage on our team. For those of you getting started, I do offer a right sizing guide, so you can most certainly email me or call me, and I'll be happy to either email or mail that out to you. And it's just getting you started on downsizing and what to be thinking about in that process. I love this quote by Franklin D. Roosevelt. Real estate cannot be lost or stolen, nor can it be carried away. Purchased with common sense, paid for in full, and managed with reasonable care, it is about the safest investment in the world. So it's really the case. I get that your home has been your real estate investment. Your home may also be part of your retirement plans. You've worked hard for that equity in your home, and I want to help you get the most out of it you can. So if you're curious about your home value or have any other questions or need a second opinion, feel free to give me a call, send me a text, drop me an email. All of my contact information is here, and I'm absolutely happy to help you in any way that I can. So I'm just stopping the recording right now, and that way if anyone has